Hello, welcome back to my channel. And welcome back to my car. Today I'm doing my September wrap-up. In terms of reading months, I feel like this was a pretty solid one. It wasn't like my most prolific reading month, and I definitely didn't read as many books not for videos as I have in the past. But the ones that I did read, I feel like were pretty solid, and I'm really excited to share them with you. So first up, let's get it rolling. I read The White Christmas Inn by Colleen Wright, and I gave this book 3 stars. Now, I was kind of on the hunt earlier this month to find some like good Christmas or holiday romances that I could recommend to y'all for a video. I'm going to be honest with you, I'm not going to be doing that anymore. There just are not very many Christmas style stories that really appeal to me or seem to be true romances. That's something that I felt was kind of the case in this book. It was a fun read, but it didn't really have the true romance component that I really wanted. So the story is kind of a, I don't want to say Love Actually type story, but it does follow multiple different characters and their own storylines as they spend kind of a snowed in Christmas at this White Christmas Inn. I cannot remember the name of the actual inn. The like main players are Molly, who's a writer. Her mother, I think, just recently passed away, and she is trying to work on her next children's book, and she's also just kind of like unsure of where she wants to go in life. She doesn't have any sort of romantic partner, and yeah, she's just sort of floundering a little bit. And she meets a single dad with some girls, and that's kind of like a romance that happens. There's also Hannah, who is supposed to be getting married at the Christmas Inn, like during Christmas time. She ends up getting, I don't want to say left at the altar because the wedding never ends up happening, but her fiance ends up texting her and saying like, yeah, I don't really want to get married anymore. So she ends up reconnecting with a guy that she used to hang out at this inn with when she was younger. So Hannah gets her own romance. And then we have Jean, or is it Jean? I don't know how to say that name. Whenever you get like Jean with a couple of N's and an E, like I lose all sense of pronunciation. Jean and Tim are the owners of the inn, and they are kind of struggling in their marriage a little bit because the inn has faced some tough financial times. So they're dealing with that and also like trying to rekindle their love and relationship. And obviously at the end, the inn is saved, and I don't know, it was a sweet story. I would say of all of the sort of like women's fiction, chick lit-y type Christmas stories that I've read, this is probably my favorite, which isn't saying much because I haven't read very many, and the ones that I have read I haven't enjoyed. But I think if you're looking for something like semi-wholesome, this might be good. I will say there was like kind of a touch of a religious component, I guess, when it came to Jean and Tim's storyline. I think like she talked about her faith a little bit, although I wouldn't say that it was like an overall super religious story, so I don't know. Take of that what you will. I thought this was fine. Would I recommend it? If it interests you at all, maybe. But like, it's something to write home about, and I wouldn't feature this in like a 6 Christmas romance recommendations video. So I picked up 1 historical romance this month. I think it was only 1, which is wild to me because I feel like I've been on such a historical kick lately, especially if you watch my wrap up from August. I read so many Lisa Kleypas books. And of course this one's going to be a Lisa Kleypas as well. I read Secrets of a Summer Night, which I gave 3 stars to. This is the first book in the Wallflower series. And this I would say is probably Lisa Kleypas's most talked about, like most hyped series. You can understand why, though this was not a perfect romance for me. So the story itself is about Annabelle and Simon. Annabelle is kind of like down on hard times. Her family is not destitute, but like they're not doing well. Annabelle has to wear like old gowns to balls, and a lot of people know of her kind of like financial situation. So she's having a really hard time finding a man. I cannot remember for the life of me if she like had turned down any proposals or whatnot, but like she's a wallflower or whatever. Simon is like the last possible guy she would ever want to marry. He's kind of a rake a little bit, and I don't think he's titled, maybe? Like I don't think he's titled, and he's just like not someone that she's into, and it's just kind of like an opposites attract kind of romance, maybe. I just didn't love this. I really liked Annabelle's character at the beginning, but I just didn't love the two characters together. I don't know. Simon was just kind of eh for me. The one thing that I did really love about this book, though, was the setup for the Wallflower series. I think that that's kind of a running theme that I'm noticing with Lisa Kleypas books. For a series, the first book is always kind of a 3-star read for me, but I'm excited about the future books. The Wallflowers are, you know, this band of girls who come together to help find each other husbands so they're off the marriage market as soon as possible. You know, everybody helps Annabelle find a husband first in this book because she's the eldest of all of them. I didn't love the romance itself, but I did like, you know, the surrounding stuff, so I probably will continue on with the series. I know I need to give Devil in Winter a second try because I DNF'd the fuck out of that book a while ago, but everybody seems to love Sebastian, so I feel like I need to give that one a second try. The next book that I read this month was a book that was hyped, very, very hyped. I started this book in like a 24-hour reading vlog, and I ended up giving this one 4 stars, which I feel like I have not had very many 4-star reads this year in general. It's Unhinged by Onlee James. This was just so fucking fun. Like, it has been so long since I've just picked up a book and been like just enamored with it from the beginning. Was it like my perfect read ever? No, it didn't need to be. It was just so fun and inviting and engaging. And sometimes I just pick up a book and I'm like, this is why I read books. You know what I mean? I've been struggling. Y'all know I've been struggling to find like books that I'm into and that have been keeping me engaged. And this one really did. I got through it so quickly. Anyway, the story is about Noah and Adam. Adam is one of like seven children who were adopted by this like scientist, psychologist, whatever, and his goal is to reform sociopathic and psychopathic children and make them killers and also make them useful to society. So they're gonna be killers and only killing bad guys that their father Thomas has like vetted and decided like need to be murdered, and he sends his kids out to do this. So Adam is one of those guys, and one day he comes across a kid in an alleyway. I say kid, he's not a child, he's in his like early 20s, comes across this guy named Noah, and Noah comes up to Adam and is like, yo, you killed my father. And Adam's like, yeah, I guess I did kill your dad like 10 years ago. And they have this sort of like, not altercation, it's nothing physical, but they kind of fight it out, and Noah finds out why his dad was murdered, and he starts uncovering some hidden memories that he had about the time with his dad. He realized that he was abused by multiple different people. He kind of mentions this to Adam later on in the story. I say later, a couple scenes later, Adam decides that he is going to team up with Noah and they are going to find all of these bad men and kill them. And that's kind of the story. It is equal parts romance, equal parts mystery, I guess, like crime fighting stuff. If you like Criminal Minds, I think you might enjoy this book. Now, the only thing that I didn't enjoy about this romance is something that I think will surprise you. I don't know if I mentioned it in my 24-hour reading vlog where I read part of this book, but there was too much smut in this book for me, which I feel like is something I rarely, if ever, say, but I just felt like there were one too many sex scenes, and they weren't poorly done or super gratuitous or like gross or anything. Not that I feel like sex scenes are ever really gross. I just didn't love it. I felt like it was a lot, and I did find myself skimming a little bit, which is something that I rarely do when it comes to like sexy scenes. So just something to like make note of if you're not someone who likes a lot of sex scenes in books, like maybe avoid this one. I don't know. Again, kind of a weird thing for me to say because that's just like not something I normally care about. It struck me, and it's a recurring theme because I decided to pick up the second book in the series next. I picked up Psycho by Onlee James. This one I didn't know how to rate, and I'll tell you why in a second. But I think I'm going to leave it at about 3.5 stars because I didn't enjoy it quite as much as Psycho. Okay, this one is about August and Lucas. August is another one of Thomas's sons, and he ends up falling for a professor at his university. They both teach, and they kind of bond over that a little bit. Lucas is a former FBI, and he is being stalked and like kind of brought into murder investigations by a guy who's also in the FBI. Like the FBI guy, he's killing people, and he keeps leaving like messages and notes to Lucas because Lucas has been kind of like on his case, and like he suspected that the FBI agent is a murderer, and so he's being taunted, I guess is what I'm trying to say, by this guy. Lucas and August team up to figure out if there are more players involved, if it's just this guy, etc., etc., and that's the story. I don't know, I had a tough time with this one, not because it was a bad story by any means, but it just felt so similar to Psycho, both in its tone and its plot and just like everything. I think it can be really hard to differentiate between characters when they all have such similar personalities. Like all of these boys were adopted because they're either sociopaths or psychopaths. That's fun for sure, like as a setup for a series, but all of them kind of have similar personalities. They all have like slightly different interests and things like that, but I didn't feel like it was enough to really differentiate the relationship. And we also have like the sweet, slightly submissive boyfriend. Like Lucas and Noah are not that different to me. In my head, they kind of get mixed up. So I don't know. It's like, was it a bad book? No, it was fun. I liked the writing. The dialogue was fun. I liked the banter between, you know, all the family members. Like that was super fun and engaging to read about, but just feel like I don't know if I'll continue on with the series because everything kind of feels the same. I don't not recommend these books, but I also, I don't know. It's like, I feel like if you read one, you've read them all. Okay, so the next two books, I gave 2 stars to. I was going to say that these were the worst books that I read this month, but if you've watched my Kindle lock screen video, you know that's probably not the case. But these sucked pretty bad too. So first up, we have Ask the Passengers by A.S. King. I ended up giving this book 2 stars. I was really disappointed with it. I had put this in a 5 stars predictions video, which is why I read this book. We'll get to it later. You'll see it later. Right? There's gonna be a video where I have read all of my 5-star predictions and let you know if they're 5-star worthy or not, whatever. This book's about our main character, Astrid, and Astrid's dealing with a lot. She is coming to terms with her sexuality. She's pretty sure that she likes women, and she's unsure if she likes men as well. She is dealing with her kind of shitty family. She has a bad relationship with her mom. Her dad smokes a lot of weed and is sort of like an absentee. She's not close with her sister. There's a lot of like relationships involved in the story. And then Astrid also has 2 friends who are gay but are pretending to date each other. So like One of her friends is a lesbian, one of her friends is gay. They're pretending to date each other so they can pass as straight, I guess, or like be the perfect high school couple. And she also has a girlfriend who is really fucking pushy and like I really hated. I just feel like the story didn't really do anything new. It didn't say anything that hasn't already been said before in a better way. And I don't mean that in a mean way. I just feel like this wasn't exactly exciting to read about. It just wasn't my thing. I don't know. It's really hard for me to talk about and discuss YA contemporaries, especially at this point in my life. I'm old. I'll be 30 in like in a couple years, and I feel so far removed from high school that it's hard for me to relate to characters at this particular age. And that's not always the case with YA contemporaries. Like, I really liked Dig by A.S. King, but that one was a lot more like metaphoric. This one is very much just like a typical YA contemporary. So I feel like if you like A.S. King, you probably won't like this book because this is not a typical book for her. And then just generally speaking, I felt like it just wasn't great. I just didn't like it. I think the big part for me too was like Astrid keeps fighting for this relationship and like fighting to be with the person she loves, but that person did not deserve love. They were so pushy when it came to Astrid's boundaries when it comes to sex. And then at the very end, like, the person apologizes, I shouldn't have been so pushy. And it's like, okay, well, like, could you not have been an asshole the entire book? I'm not gonna continue to talk about this one because I feel like this book likely has value for someone. I'm just not that person. So next up, oh my god, this book, like, I just want to sigh when I'm thinking about this book, when I'm talking about this book. Rhythm, Chord, and Malakin by Mariana Zapata. I gave this book 2 stars. I was so disappointed by this one because it had so much potential, right? Like, I love a good rock star romance if it's done well, and I feel like this one could have been done well had all of the extra bullshit not been added in. Okay, so the story is about Gabby and Sasha. Gabby is going on tour with her brother and her brother's band, her twin brother, I think his name's Eli, her twin brother and his band, and she is going to sell merch on their tour. They are going on tour with another band, and she ends up developing a crush and ends up in a relationship with the lead singer, whose name is Sasha. I liked it. I liked the setting a whole lot. I thought it was really, like, fun. You get to see them on the road, on tour, how, like, unglamorous it is. It's got that signature Mariana Zapata writing style, so you get a lot of dialogue, you get a lot of slow burn goodness without it being overly long. Mariana Zapata's books have increased in length over time, so her, like, first few releases are a reasonable length, and I liked that about this book. It felt like it was an appropriate length. And here's the but, the really, really big but. There was so much unnecessary shit in here, and it made me angry. Like, why? There are so many, like, transphobic, misogynistic, homophobic jokes made for absolutely no reason. I mean, not that there would ever be a reason, but like, why? Just why? No. And it's one of those books that I just, like, cannot recommend in good conscience, because it wasn't like it happened once, and it wasn't like it was something that was a mistake or something that was, you know, could be misconstrued. Like, it was very much on paper, offensive, fucked up, happened multiple times. I was listening to the audiobook and I was just like, it felt like a punch every single time it happened, and I'm just like, why? Why? What's the reason? Yeah, I cannot recommend this book to people, and it's got me kind of rethinking my Mariana Zapata guide to that I want to do. If I'm doing a guide to an author, I don't want to have to say, fuck this book. It just, I don't know. Something I will be considering going forward, but didn't love it, and I guess it kind of makes me think, you know, was I maybe ignoring were these things in other books of hers and I just didn't realize it? I don't know. I just, ugh. And then lastly, a book that took me by surprise in a good way. Let's end it on a good note, right? I read What If You and Me by Ronnie Lauren, I think that's the author's name. I'll put a picture of the book right here and you can know what the title and who the author is. This was just nice. I picked this one up from Libro FM. I picked the first book up in paperback form at Barnes & Noble because I just wanted to randomly pick up a book that seemed interesting to me based on the synopsis. Still haven't read that one, but I got this one from Libro because I had heard of the author from picking up the first book. That was an explanation that literally no one needed. This story is about Andy and Hill, and it is a romance about trauma, I guess, and recovering from trauma. So Andy is a horror author and podcast maker. She, like, makes podcasts about horror and also, like, women's safety tips. So, you know, just ensuring that women are staying safe given how horrible certain men can be. And then Hill is a retired firefighter. He had to retire because he got in, I don't want to say an accident, but I feel like whenever someone says accident, you think car accident. Anyway, he got in an accident while he was firefighting. He has burns and he lost both of his legs in the fire. So he is kind of dealing with the trauma from that and also the depression that came along with it. His fiance ended up dumping him in his recovery, so he's also dealing with some, like, feelings of romantic and sexual inadequacy. And then Andy is traumatized by something in her her past. I don't think it is a spoiler to say, but Andy was in a relationship with a murderer, and she was kind of not coerced into the relationship, but she was very manipulated in that relationship. She was very young, and she's still dealing again with the repercussions of that. She has a hard time getting intimate with people. So they're both kind of dealing with their individual traumas, and they end up kind of living next door to each other, end up kind of like having a little meet cute situation, and it's a romance. I don't really know what else to say about the plot of the book. It's about them working through their traumas together and healing and growing and having a successful romantic relationship. It was really, really cute. It was a book that took me by surprise. I feel like from the cover, you think this is going to be chick lit women's fiction, and it isn't really that. I mean, there's explicit sex in this book, and it is focused on the romance the entire book. I thought it was really great. I think if you are looking for something realistic and you want something that feels cozy despite the subject matter, I feel like this is a good book. It is very dialogue heavy. There's not like traveling or anything going on. Like, they're kind of in one place the entire time, and it was just like, it just felt nice to read. The only thing that I didn't like about this book was that there is a conflict near the end of the book that kind of brings our characters back together in a way, but it focuses on Andy becoming re-traumatized, and I didn't like that. I did not feel like that was a touch that needed to be added into the story, even if it was realistic. I did not appreciate it. But other than that kind of like cringy kind of conflict at the end, I liked it. I thought it was a good romance, and it was something that took me by surprise, and it was something that I wouldn't hesitate to recommend to people who are just looking for like a classic romance with maybe some like updated modern themes of mental health and healing and recovery. And yeah, so it was good. If you're looking for a book also with a hero who's not an asshole, this is one for you. That's it. Those are the 7 books that I read this month. This video is quite short, which I like. I hope you liked it too. I'm hoping next month is a good reading month as well. I feel like I was coming to terms recently with the fact that I don't really know how much time I'm gonna have going forward to read things that are not for videos. I think I counted, I've scheduled through the end of December. I've talked about that before. I counted all the books, and it was like over 100 books that I still need to read. And I just like, I know I can do it, but to do that, I don't know that I'll have time to read books that are not specifically for videos. So will you see another wrap up this year? I don't know. We'll see. I have like 2 books checked out from the library right now that I want to read that aren't for videos, but other than that, we'll see. What a way to end a video, right? In the comments down below, let me know what your favorite book that you read in this month was. I'd love to know. I'll add it to my TBR if it sounds interesting to me, and maybe it'll help other people find good reads as well. Let me know if you've read any of the books that I featured in this video, and let me know your thoughts, because I'm always curious. Especially if you've read like Unhinged or Psycho. I want to know your thoughts on that book specifically. But I love y'all so much. Thanks so much for watching. Hope y'all are having a fantastic Sunday or whatever day you're watching this. But until next Sunday.